What I'm actually sharing with you is, and even that completely changed my understanding of children. I used to live in a small village of non-literate artisans in Nilambur with potters, potter community, and I was doing some experiments with them. Experiments in no teaching. I will share that also with you. So during the 2 months holidays, I started doing some, you know, work with children. And that was a time when I was very clear that senses are our tools to understand the world, something that we don't use at all in our whole schooling system. So that's why I purposely called it sensing nature, knowing nature. And I still had the hangover of NID, so I was trying to do some exercises that we were doing at NID, you know, when I studied at the design school, you know. So I got them to do a similar exercise that you did. So that is what I wanted to share with you, you know. So this was, basically senses are our doors to the outer world, but it is also the door to the inner world. Modern education doesn't address the inner world at all. That's the basic fundamental problem. This is denied completely. It is only about the outside that we are engaging with. But what happens is that, meanwhile, this gets destroyed. That is what we don't understand. It's not a neutral situation. You know, if this doesn't wake up, then we are dead. You know, we are walking dead, actually. You know, the literates are walking dead. So children actually, in the process of engaging with the world, awaken their inner world. So inner world is far more important than the outer world. Outer world is a means for our awakening and realizing our potential. No? So it's actually absurd to sensitize senses, because that is what we are born with. No? But schooling systematically kills it. That is why we need to go back to this and, you know, consciously start looking, you know. Because this doesn't work. I mean, you may think I'm, you know, talking nonsense, but the eyes, but you know, you all answered blue color, no? It simply shows that you have not been seeing, no? We are conditioned to believe in a certain set of knowledge, no? The same question was asked to children in a school, you know, seventh standard or something like that. So the children are asking, well, what time of the day are you talking about? We don't have those questions, no? We are of the past. Children are of the present. So there is going to be a mismatch in modern educated people trying to understand children, because you two belong to two different worlds. And what we are doing is continuously taking them away from that world and putting them into our mediocre world. We are mediocre. I hope you understand this. Absolute mediocres. Because authenticity is nothing that we can deal with, because we have never used our being for, you know, engagement with the world. We are second-hand people, you know. It's better that we understand this first. Don't make any illusions about it. Then at least we can start working on it, you know. Otherwise, we have this notion that we are all great guys, you know. It's a tragedy, you know. I always wonder that if you ask the tree, whom do they want? Do they want the educated or the uneducated? What would they prefer? It's obvious, no? We are looking for nature, no? That's a strange idea that we have. We are nature. We don't have to look for nature. But we have killed it. That's the whole problem that has happened. So because this workshop was kind of a detoxification kind of thing, you know, 6, 7, 8 months of school. So you have 2 months of, you know, just observing and working on your senses. So we began, you know, we sit around, sit in silence. Listen, actually, you know, this is something that I did in 2000. I don't think I will repeat any of this thing again. So don't take notes. All right? Don't take notes. Children need not be done anything. These days there is this mindfulness program for children. Absolute nonsense. Because children are mindful. It is the adult who is unmindful. You know, so the tragedy is that we want to impose our authority on children all the time. This is the problem. You know, they are mindful. So this, I'm sorry, I did this workshop. I shouldn't have done it because they are mindful, you know. But of course, I didn't use the terms like that, no? Mindfulness and all that. We were sitting silently and listening to what was happening around, you know, the birds, small sounds that are happening, you know. And traditional games, if you look at any of the activity that children do, it is basically to awaken their processes inside. There is no football happening there. There is no planned games. Everything children do, you go to any traditional society, whatever games children play spontaneously has to do with awakening some of their qualities to understand the world. So there is this game that, you know, children, somebody will throw something and children has to then go and find out. This is a natural, you know, a game that every children play, you know, earlier days. And this is to do with your sensing, your observation, you know. Everything that children do is to awaken their senses and abilities to understand the world, you know. So this is something that now I wouldn't do these things. That's why I don't take notes. This is something that I did because I didn't realize the true ability of children, you know. So this is what we did, you know, what we just did. And luckily what happened was that I didn't have money. So I could only buy the poster color with 6 colors. If I had the money, I would have bought them 12 colors, you know. But thank God, I didn't have. So I bought only 6 colors. And to my surprise, I found that every child was able to mix and match and get the exact color. That's why I told this is not an artistic activity, it's a scientific activity. Learn how to do it. Understand? Now this is the kind of color that children, you know. So I got them to observe, just get the brown colors, shades of brown. Put them. And then, you know, mixed and matched and got all the colors. So this was actually very surprising for me that children are just able to do it. So I did while I was doing a workshop in the school, Hyderabad, in a school, I gave the same exercise to all the teachers. But I also got the ayahs and drivers to this place. I wanted to see how they would do it. And, I mean, it's quite obvious that none of the teachers were able to do it. But all the ayahs and drivers, because they did not go through this idea of schooling, they were able to do it. You know? Because the first response of an educated, first is fear. You know? Or we use reasoning. We think this color with that color, this color, you know. So we have a very structured, logical way of trying to find this out. And children seems to have a method which is not reasoning. They're able to just do it, you know. Because we, again, from the modernistic perspective, we have this idea that, knowledge is a matter of trial and error. You heard that, no? Trial and error. That's not true at all. It's because none of the biological beings do trial and error. A bird doesn't do trial and error to enter its nest. Do they? There is no trial and error. Because as biological beings, that is what we are meant to do. You know, what happens is that for a child, it's a strengthening of the muscle that is taking time, not its ability to walk. Don't mix that with trial and error. Understand? There's no trial and error in biological systems. Clear? Because that is the nature of life. There's no trial and error. But there is something that, again, which is opposing to the modern notion. Because we keep talking about don't reinvent the wheel. You heard that? Life is always about reinventing the wheel. There is nothing new. This is an absurd idea. But newness comes in renewal. It is new because you are doing it. That is the newness. No? And that is authenticity. Understand? Whole modern knowledge is about copying. So there is nothing new in that. So they have to create an idea called creativity to create something new. It doesn't exist. So this is the kind of space that I will just take you through this, you know, this so like somebody did here, you know. So this we did, but here it is very clearly by observing. It's not from my mind. So they went and picked up leaves that are different shades, you know, put them together and then repeated it. So that gives a more observational, you become more sensitive to color. That's what happens. You can see one side is the original, this is the color. This child got into architecture. We got more, you know, only this 2 months workshops I used to do, and children really got interested in few things, you know. Of course, this was a very, very economically backward, poor society, so many of them couldn't do anything further. So then also we started doing the regular idea of color scale. Then what we did just now, picked up leaf and started coloring. Actually, once you go through this kind of a activity for few days and create a habit of seeing, then you will find that everything in nature seems to be beautiful. You know? Otherwise, normally when you talk about beauty, people go and pluck flower and come. You know? Where that has been established, flower beautiful, you know. So this is an interesting thing that when children go for this, botanical gardens, you know, till the age of 7, 8, they will see the tree and, you know, all that. After that, they only read and come back. They would remember all the names of the plants, you know, but seeing stops after that. Because the two different activities actually, reading. In fact, I stopped reading completely for a few years. And I found that reading doesn't take effort at all. You look at the billboards. When you travel, you don't see the trees, the, you know, all that. But billboards go into you. You don't have to make an effort at all for the words to go in, you know. But actually to see, you need effort. Because seeing needs presence. Your whole being needs to be present to see. But for reading, it's only the mind that is required. You don't need to put an effort, you know. And this is what happens, because all along, we are only doing thinking and reasoning. This is all what we are engaging with. We are in the realm of language, you know. So the other part stops working. Yeah? With dry leaves. So this was another revelation that children create beauty. It's not an effort. You know, they don't have to learn how to compose. Composition is in our nature. No? Because composition is fundamentally a biological property. What I mean by that is that when you find something composed, the effort that you need to put is least. That's the reason. You find something beautiful because that enters you much faster than a clutter. No? So it's actually a cognitive need. Understand? Actually, you know, the issue is that we will have to do a complete deletion of the notions that we are carrying. You know, like what he said in the morning, that the idea of teaching was absent in the rural tribal area, in our Indian languages. You know, like yesterday I was mentioning, the notion of waste is absent. Something that we don't even understand. That why is the notion of waste absent in people? You know, well, they belong to nature. That's the reason. Nature doesn't have waste. Nature just doesn't have teaching. So naturally, people who are nature-centric doesn't have the notion of teaching. No? So once I remember Pawan Gupta was telling in Mussoorie. So he had gone to some villages and many years ago, and they wanted him to teach the village children. So what the people were telling him was that, can you learn our children? But they didn't have the word teaching. Understand? So can you learn our children? You see? So, you know, I think what I'm trying to say is that with the framework in the paradigm that you are in, you're not going to understand learning. It's a complete makeover, complete redoing that is required to truly understand what is learning. Because we have created so many categories to mislead. Understand? So it's actually a much deeper process. It is not a information exchanging process that is happening. You know? Understand? It's not an information idea. That unless you begin to work on yourself, you know, continuously be aware of what you are, you know, your notions, then you are not going to understand, because we don't have the ability to see. What we are seeing is what the mind has created. You know, the categories that the mind has created, that is what we are seeing. Children don't play. But we assume they are playing. No, everybody thinks they play is now the worst damaging word that they have created. There is no play. There is playfulness. You know, but we are mixing this. Because we need another category called learning, which is separate from playing. You see, now they are trying to mix it again. But they have not understood it. You know, so what I am trying to say is that it's a journey. That if you undertake, you know, then slowly you will, the child will reveal to you what it is, what its potential is, you know, provided you are willing to undo your own frames. Mommy. Yeah? So this I'm just sharing with you the other part also. But this workshop, actually, we had about 60 children and different activities they were doing. So some are using old magazines, some are doing color, you know, leaf, different activities. So I just thought, let me share this with you. You see, children learning from each other is a very different thing than when an adult sits and starts doing. You know? Children are innocently engaging with each other. But that is not the relationship the moment an adult comes there. That is why it is very dangerous these days that we are letting the adult play with children. Because adults play with a different mindset. Children doesn't have that problem, no? It is not that they are not careful, no? They really look for it. You know, like when they had decided something, I've seen this girl really looking around for something, you know. I mean, she knew what to do, you know. So it's not that it is mindless also, you know. And then what is very interesting is that there is no notion of a rule in them. Right? They're very easily, because they don't think that there are rules. You know? So, they're mixing now leaf and paper. They're not breaking rule, by the way. Our notion is to break a rule, which is again absurd. Because we think there are rules, we need to break it. See? There is no notion of a rule in a child. You know, I'm talking about man-made rules, you know, that doesn't exist. So they are so easily able to, you know, playfully move around, you know. Because see, that I'm pointing out this because we have created unwanted activist mode in these things, you know. We need to break a rule, you know, I mean, that kind of thing. Because I think, you know, to be very frank, I feel that activism is doing more harm. Because activism is thinking that they are doing good. You know? I think homeschooling is dangerous equally. Same thing with alternative schooling. The other one, you know, it's like the case of a zoo. At least the animal knows it is caged. Other one doesn't know they are caged. Simple. You see, that's what is happening. So we create this notion that we are active is doing something. We need to shift that mode completely. Because it is not, this is all reactions. But within the same framework. You know? So, it's not easy. I mean, I think, you know, life is giving us a different opportunity, I think. You know? I think it's a much deeper spiritual process. You know, there is a story that I was in a conference few days ago. So, a story that occurred to me was this. That, I mean, the story that is established is something else, but, you know, I didn't remember that. So I made up a part of the story. It was this, that a little bird saw, two-legged little bird saw this 100 feet, no, centipede walking. So the bird was wondering, how does this guy walk with 100 feet? So he came, goes and asked him, how do you know which leg to put, you know? So the centipede waited for a minute and started looking at its feet and wondering which leg to put. And it lost its ability to walk. You see? So this is what has happened to learning. Learning is the most natural process. It is a life's process. You know, every living being is learning. It's not a human activity. We have been given some part of that. That's all. You know? What an owl can see, or what a bat can see, or, you know, sense, is very different from what we can do. Understand? So within our senses, there is a world that is available to us. But we don't seem to be using it, you know. We don't seem to be doing what we are meant to do biologically, you know. This I will talk about this later, because I've been trying to work on something like this, that how do you shift the focus from products into processes, into inner abilities than outer abilities, no? We'll talk about that later. This also, drawing, I have done a much deeper study on drawing. This I will share with you later on the, actually, we are only attempting to learn the world. This is all what we are doing. There is nothing called art. Art, again, is a modern construct. So we will go into that. And I am telling this only by experiencing children. All right. By documenting, so what I did was continuously document children. Observe them and document them. This is what I did. And I also stopped reading, as I told you, completely. Which also shifted the way my process work. I don't do reasoning. I don't do thinking and imagining. I don't do all that. You know, I do thinking based on what I've experienced. Understand? Yeah? But for most educated people, this doing experience is absent. Thought is happening all the time. One book to another book to another book to another book. Understand? So it's in the realm of language and thought and mind. Understand? With no relevance to the ground, to experience.
It's a mix of both also, right? It's experience as well as what you learned. It's what you've learned in the past as well as what somebody else has experienced and documented. It's a cumulative experience that you can also get by reading something.
No, you don't do that. I mean, this is all very good to, talk about. So don't try to escape. Face the fact that we are idiots. Let's stay there, don't worry about, day after you can forget about it. But at least for 3 days, please take it from me that we are all cognitively damaged people. You can deny it after 3 days. You can say you're the greatest guy and go away, no problem. But if you want truly understand a child which doesn't belong to your paradigm, stop your, illusions about knowledge and all that. Let's, understand child from a slightly different, or learning, basically learning from a different perspective altogether, It's very interesting that the child never thinks what they have drawn is wrong. Till you will you keep insisting that, no, this is not the way. No, child never thinks like that. Very clearly a scratch will tell this is his mother or something like that. The child is very clear. You see? Like this, she has no doubt that she has drawn there is this. That and this. If you look closely, that is absolute abstraction of this. The essence she is able to get. Understand? And it is age specific. At a certain age, like a crawling child, no? Very clearly, age matters in that, no? So these activities were fully focused on observation. We were not really, it was a surprise for me that children are just able to do. But the focus was basically of the senses, of process, of observation. We use terms like underprivileged, correct, no? Now, that's a category that we have created for our convenience. Understand? So, this is the frames that are being created for you to see through and treat them as underprivileged. No? They don't feel that at all. They're fine till you tell them, no, you're poor. No? Actually, there is this interesting movie Helena Norberg, who was in Ladakh. You know, she's an anthropologist and linguist, I think, who did a movie and a book first called Ancient Futures. Ancient Futures. Very interesting study on when she went to that Ladakhi community, nobody ever felt they are poor. They had no idea, you know. Then as she began to go there, you know, as development began to take place, slowly, slowly they started owning up, oh, they are poor. So this impoverishment is a political activity. It's not, you know, purposely designed. You see? It's a psychological activity actually, you know. So you feel inferior. Like education. Exactly the same thing that we do with education.
What do you have to say about now they have this term of special children? What have you to say about that?
Actually, you know, I mean, the West is churning out so many new terminologies, you know. There is something called disobedient child or something like that. So many, you know. So many, actually, you know. If the child doesn't obey the mother, then that's a disease of the child, you know. So it's termed that. There is something, no? Obedient what? It's called? No, that's a different thing. There is a new thing which is about disobeying. Child doesn't obey, then that is treated as a, you know, problem, a disease. Yeah. So this was a very, very interesting event. I couldn't believe that somebody could, you know, this such beautiful things can be drawn. So, I started telling it's so beautiful, and I repeated that, and she stopped drawing after that. Actually, this is another extremely interesting, you know, shift that I found. In a rural kind of situation, a child will never come back asking for parents' approval. Everything is done for them, not for exhibiting. The shift we have made, that every stupid activity they do, they have to say very good. Yeah. If they don't do very good, then it's a problem. Yeah. You know? So you are conditioning the child to actually be stupid. You know? I feel the very act of teaching is because you consider them as stupid, no? You know? It's a unwritten idea that unless you consider them as idiots, you can't do teaching. You know?
Only as much as I tell you.
No, actually, it is far more a deeper existential crisis, which is that a biological being is learning all the time. It's his nature. Then you're telling them, no, you go and learn from there. You know? So there's a confusion about its own creation of knowledge, which the being is doing. You know? Each cell is doing that, no? But the mind is being told, no. Education means somebody will teach you. That is what where knowledge is, you know. So there is a much more unsaid, deeper crisis that, you know.
And then we end up becoming victims.
Absolutely. See, you see, this whole ecological disaster that we are creating is because of a damaged mind. Understand? So, but we are again and again trying to repair the outer world. We are not addressing that this is an inner problem. What we have done inside, we are only repeating outside. It's a denial of biology actually. It's the denial of a fundamental part of our life that we do by going through education, by reading, by thinking, you know. It's a denial of the whole system. So this was interesting that they on their own started using laterite stones and digging different color from that. You know laterite stones that you find here, no? So much of color, all this color is taken from the laterite, no? So just taking color from stones, and so that's what I meant, that this is completely a free-flowing exploration. And then one day I saw them using that onto paper, you know, and that went on to another kind of activity. So so when you leave that space open, it's a continuous process that children are, you know, doing, you know. So this was 100% no instruction activity, huh? Except of course organizing that, you know, materials, this like what we did today, you know. Understand? So it's interesting how they began to explore different types of materials that they can use. You know, people who are familiar with coconut, on that what you call that thing, on that leaf. On the side, there is this dust that you know, that you can scrape out. This is that, you know. And that white color is rock, ash, you know. So it is so interesting that children were, you know, all around trying to, you know. Yeah. This is the laterite. So they transferred that onto paper, you know. Initially, it was just geometric things that went onto paper, and then they started doing the scenery kind of things, you know. So, we were also doing, working in clay. One group was handling clay, again, recreating the village. This is an interesting thing. This is not done in a potter's community, this particular activity. It's interesting to see how a potter's child would handle clay and a non-potter child would handle that. That ladder that you see, a potter's child will have a notion that it has to be fired. So they would never use a stick there, you know. You can see that another very interesting aspect is that children always like to work together. You know?
Social.
Huh?
Social.
Yeah, they always like to work in groups, you know, few people together. Exactly opposite of what we do in schools, no? So you can see the quality in that, you know, that the that you can see the effort that the bull is putting. Yeah? So I kept on introducing small activities, you know. And again, here, what another very interesting thing is that the gender division had not taken place, you know. So boys also would do stitching. There's no such notion that it is only for girls. Actually, this is a very modern construct, this whole idea of gender. And it is also because of the denial of the body, denial of the biology in us, you know, this whole. So what I feel is that within the context of modernity, there is only male principle at work, masculine principle at work, you know, which also means that there is bound to be denial of the feminine. So it's not just the feminine there, the feminine in me has been denied, you know. So within this context, it is bound to happen like this only. There is no other change that is possible, because again, it's an internal issue. Unless we begin to work as an integration of our inner being, externally nothing can happen. No? So this was a very interesting activity again. Here also no teaching. They were doing just simple line stitch, you know. But this anybody can do. Nobody needs a training for that, you know. Just line stitch. And within that, they're exploring, you know, what kind of, how do you chain the lines. For example, in this, you know, she has just stretched the whole thing. One line, you know. So this exploration is, it's very innate in us. Mm? Actually, if you remove the category called art, no, everything is fine. You should move into understanding beauty. Beauty is not art. Every activity is bound to be beautiful. You know, it could be a barber doing or a chapati making, every activity. It's only when we create a category called art, then we create a different problem in that society, you know. This is very interesting activity that we had undertaken, looking at the negative spaces, you know. And also what I would like to say is that it's not something that we started doing it right from day one, all this, you know. So there was a continuous growth that was happening, you know. Few activities happened and it went on for a few years, 5-6 years this went on, you know. So something that I have been looking at that would be introduced, you know, like an activity like this. Of course, I introduced it, you know. But then you begin to see magic happening here. Because, see, look at the way that this child has handled this portion. Just look at this. So beautiful, you know. But this requires real intelligence, no? And look at the care that has to go into this, because this is not, it can't be just done. So all this activity are meditative activities, you know. You have to pay attention. Look at this, look at the tendrils here, you know, look at this, how they have treated that. So there is a continuous challenge that they put to themselves, you know, to do something complex. You know?